Good morning, brothers and sisters, and welcome as we celebrate the life of Leona Florence Kirkham Gray. For your information, the family prayer was given by Jared D. Gray, Leona's son. Her music has been provided by Keisha Herbst, and our chorister today will be Ann Phelan. Our opening hymn will be hymn number 293, Each Life That Touches Ours for Good, after which our invocation will be offered by Brother Lane Holm, a son-in-law.
Primary melody performed by
Abby Jepson, and accompanied by Amber Summers. We'll then be privileged to hear from Michael D. Gray, Leona's son, after which another musical selection, O Divine Redeemer, performed by Josh Ridge, accompanied by Arthur Summers. And then our final speaker will be Brother David Gray, and we'll, her husband, and we'll proceed to that.
Mom's Life Sketch. Leona Florence Curtin was born on February 17, 1946, in Lehi, Utah. She was the daughter of William Leon Violet Florence Robbins Curtin. She was number seven, the second youngest of out of eight children. Mom was gorgeous and vibrant, 6 pound, 6 ounce baby born with copious amounts of coal black hair. Her distinguished hair at birth made the nurses want to parade her around the hospital. Mom grew up in a little family farm where they had chickens, cows, and pigs. Mom liked the farm animals, but she didn't adore all the animals on the property. Mom despised snakes. Mom's steadfast work ethic when she was a young bitch, she has happily volunteered to help her parents inside and outside of the home. Mom learned that being willing to help the had an unknown downside. One day, Mom was tasked to pull weeds outside, but unbeknownst to her, enormous snakes lurked in the yard and planter boxes. Mom will never forget her close encounter with a particularly thick garter snake she was weeding. Some of Mom's earliest childhood memories were when she and her seven siblings went to Yellowstone. All eight children somehow miraculously squeezed into an old four-door sedan where the two youngest, Mom and Margie, sat on the floor on small stools between their oldest siblings' legs. The long, cramped drive was all part of an adventure that led to wonderful memories at the cabin they stayed in at Yellowstone National Park. Mom loved attending school in Lehi, where she was a great student. One day, during sixth grade, Mom discovered a $20 bill outside a bar while walking home from school. When asked what she did with the money, she said she decided to keep the money because it would be hard to find the rightful owner. After all, it's not like I could go into the bar and find the owner. Mom's relentless work ethic continued to blossom when she was 16 years old. Mom worked for Saratoga Springs Resort and picked raspberries until she graduated from Lehi High School in 1964. Mom used the money that she earned to pay for cheerleading and the pep club. Mom cheered from 9th to 12th grade. She loved to cheer and attend all Lehi High School dances. And she'll never forget her first car, a green 1955 Chevrolet four-door, three-speed steering column standard shift. After high school, Mom attended Comptometer School and worked for Sears for about 1 year. At Comptometer School, Mom became certified as an IBM key punch operator and a Comptometer adding collecting calculating machine operator. Mom ran for Miss Lehi after the Lehi pageant team encouraged her to do so. She delighted the judges with her variety act, which consisted of playing the piano and wearing clothes that she sewed by hand. The persuaded judges crowned her Miss Lehi in 1965. Mom and Dad's love story began when her sister Linda and her husband Dick Meekum set Mom and Dad up on a blind date. The blind date began when they dined at the Habitable El Azteca in Provo, Utah. Dad started the night brimming with confidence until he found out at dinner that Mom was Miss Lehi. Dad's confidence quickly dissipated and he felt deflated after hearing this untold fact about Mom. Dad thought, oh, that's great. I'm just a farm boy dining with the Lehi royalty. Just how in the world am I going to win over Miss Lehi? All was not lost for Dad. After dinner, they went to the BYU basketball game, where Dad discovered that Mom not only loved basketball, but she also knew the game. Now Dad was feeling some traction. At least I'd have a chance, he thought. Sure enough, Mom and Dad were married 14 months later. During Mom and Dad's dating years, Mom stated that she absolutely loved holding Dad's hand because They were the biggest, softest, warmest hands she had ever held. Dad asked Mom to marry him on the top of an alpine loop on a September night during a memorable full moon. The glowing moon illuminated the forest. The trees romantically swayed back and forth in the breeze on that unforgettable night. When Dad pulled out the ring, Mom immediately accepted the proposal joyfully, embraced Dad. Mom and Dad were married and sealed in time and all eternity on April 14th, 1967 in the Salt Lake Temple. Mom remembers feeling overwhelmed with joy in the house of the Lord as she looked into Dad's eyes, knowing that Dad was her man forever. Mom was adored, has adored Dad for over 56 years as her lifelong companion and her best friend. When the newlyweds searched for a place to live, Dad found a humble little gem of a home named Jack's House. Dad liked the house because he thought it was a still of a deal and it would allow Dad to continue playing on the softball and basketball teams with his friends in the ward. But Mom wasn't so fond of the prospective new rental property. In fact, Mom said at first glance she didn't want anything to do with it for multiple reasons. Some of which included a gigantic pine tree with branches that blocked the front door, an old coal stove, literally no closets, pool string lights, a floor heater that would be dangerous for future children, and having only one misty cool room and bathroom weren't very helpful either. Mom couldn't resist Dad's charm, though, and artful persuasion, so she agreed to live in Jack's house. After all, Mom would happily live anywhere with her sweetheart. Mom and Dad lived and raised three children in tiny Jack's house before building their dream home in the northern part of American Fork. As a newlywed couple, Mom loved attending BYU games with Dad. Also, Mom would eagerly wait for her sweetheart to arrive home from work. She could surprise him with freshly cooked dinners and desserts like cakes, pies, and cookies. Mom loved to surprise Dad with something different every day. Mom and Dad loved to fish at Strawberry, Schofield, and Deer Creek Reservoirs. They often fished at Deer Creek Reservoir when Dad got off work. After dropping off the kids from Grandma and Grandpa's house, they would rent a little wooden boat that Dad could put an outdoor motor on. Like a fishing tournament team, Dad would run up the engine, pull out all the lines, and Mom would catch one fish after another. Dad would net the fish and rebait the hooks. It would only take a couple hours for Mom and Dad to catch their fish bag limits. Then they would be off to pick up the kids and drop off a couple fish to Grandma and Grandpa. Mom also loved going hunting with Dad. During Mom's first deer hunting excursion, Dad had her do what was called a canyon push or drive through the forest. This meant that Mom would have to bravely walk alone and make noise as she crawled over and under logs that deadfall that were bigger than her. Mom said she was praying that she would be all right as she trekked through the forest with Dad. Mom's prayers were answered because she pushed the deer out of the canyon for Dad and she came out of the trees right where Dad was standing. Mom continued to hunt with Dad and was ready to push the canyon again for deer. But Dad never took Mom up on that offer as Dad didn't want to risk his love, true love, getting hurt, lost, or becoming cougar prey. Mom and Dad developed an affinity for camping and spending time in the mountains. Early on in their marriage, this led Mom discovering her favorite place in the world. A beautiful, magnificent place tucked into the Manti Lasalle Mountains. One trip to the Manti Lasalle Mountains, Mom and Dad were walking through the secluded area of the forest when they discovered a perfect aspen tree to carve their names into. This tree dubbed the Sweetheart Tree. Every year, Mom and Dad would have a picnic at the Sweetheart Tree and carve all their new children, children's spouses, grandchildren's, grandchildren's spouses, and great-grandchildren's name in this tree. This tree still stands and bears all Mom and Dad's posterity on it. Mom loved visiting the Sweetheart Tree, as well as all of the memories derived from it. It would be an understatement to say that Mom loved being a mom. She absolutely loved caring for her children, cooking unforgettable dinners and desserts, helping with schoolwork, attending all the children's sporting events and activities. Mom had an extraordinarily kind, loving nature about her. She relished every opportunity to selfless put her children's needs before her own. No matter what it was, Mom always wanted to help her children, even if that meant helping them find a job. For instance, Mom's desire to help her oldest son, Michael, find a job led to her indirectly starting MD Property Services. Mom went and knocked on the door at the construction company's model home and asked if her son could mow their lawn. One yard led to another yard, and this led and started a new reowned landscape maintenance business. Mom taught every one of her seven children how to work by cleaning, cooking, and doing yard work. For instance, Mom taught all of her children how to harvest or pick a garden. After picking the garden as a family, we would enjoy the fruits of our labor by cooking and canning delicious freshly picked fruits and vegetables. However, Mom will never forget this one time after harvesting chard, when an unwelcome grasshopper somehow hitchhiked his straight from the chard leaf into the pan and then onto our dinner plate. Mom was flabbergasted when she discovered what had happened, and she didn't want to try this unexpected ancient culinary delicacy. Mom was a devout member of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. Mom thoroughly enjoyed and was grateful for her opportunity to serve in the primary of the Relief Society as a pianist for many years. Playing piano in the primary was a dream calling for Mom. As a natural child caregiver and musical connoisseur, Mom smoothly transitioned and excelled in her primary church calling. Mom was delighted to teach the gospel to her children through music in the primary. Mom could sing and play numerous, if not all, the primary songs by heart. Mom also spread her love of music by teaching piano lessons to others. Mom often said, "Music lift her soul and made her come alive." Mom cherished spending time with her family and going on family trips. Mom treasured every yearly family camping trip to the Sweetheart Tree and visiting Yellowstone and Utah National Parks. Any time that Mom got to visit her seven children was a great time for Mom. Mom will also never forget traveling 6 months pregnant with baby number seven to a romantic Hawaii getaway with Dad. Mom loved tropical flowers, the Hawaii Temple, and the Polynesia Cultural Center. Mom had various health challenges through her life, but these challenges only refined her and perfected her uncanny character and attributes of love, kindness, and selflessness. One could say that Mom was the queen of silver linings. Her unbreakable and enduring faith enabled her to see a glimmer of hope under dire circumstances. This faith allowed Mom to fearlessly overcome any obstacle in her life. Mom will cherish and always remember when her children did their best to uplift her spirits during health struggles. For instance, Mom adored Christmas time. She always went above and beyond Christmas special for her children. One Christmas, when she was suffering from phlebitis and inflamed leg veins, the children asked Mom, what she wanted for Christmas. Mom responded with, "You know, I just really wish I could have some new legs for Christmas. That would be wonderful." So the children gave Mom an unimaginable gift that she'll never forget. The children wrapped up the biggest boxes known to mankind and handed it to Mom. "What is this?" asked Mom. "Whatever it is too much," she said. The children reassured her, "Come on, open it. You'll never guess what it is." After Mom finally removed all the wrapping paper, she was astonished to find two mannequin legs lying in the box. Mom laughed and cried, saying, "Oh my goodness, you did it. You really got me new legs." Mom was sorely missed. However, what we have enjoyed deeply, we can never lose. Mom would be the first to say that because of her everlasting gospel, families are eternal, and we'll all be reunited someday.
Mom survived by dad and her seven children. Colette, Jeanette, Shalise, Michael, Adley, Jared, and Stephen. In addition, Mom survived by 29 grandchildren and 13 great-grandchildren. Furthermore, Mom survived by her siblings, Richard, Robert, Norman, Linda, and Manji. Mom was preceded in death by her parents, Leon and Violet, and her brother Melvin and sister Connie, and grandson Keaton. Thank you, Mom, for exemplifying what it means to be righteous, kind, and a patient person, as well as all the love and wonderful memories. We love you. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen.
There are many different words that remind me of Mom, but four of the most applicable are family, perseverance, faith, and love. Because Mom was a deeply religious person, it would be fitting to use a few scripture verses to describe Mom. For instance, 1 Corinthians 13, 4-7 describes Mom's love when stating, quote, "Love is patient and kind. Love does not envy or boast. It is not arrogant or rude. It does not insist on its own way. It is not irritable or resentful. Does not rejoice at wrongdoing, but rejoices with the truth. Love bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, and endures all things." Mom exemplified this love throughout her life, especially when caring for her seven children. Growing up, Mom was the best mom a child could ask for, and she always had a delicious dinner prepared. Mom's home-cooked meals were priceless, literally. So good money couldn't buy them, whether that be a divine meat pie, a delightful meatloaf and stuffed peppers, a savory chicken and noodles, or an exquisite apple pie. And I'll never forget all the custom design and decorative cakes that Mom made for birthdays. Whether that be a basketball cake or an Easter bunny cake, Mom's cakes were as creative as they were tasty. In addition to plentiful dinners and birthday cakes, Mom always did everything else that a child would need or could ever ask for. Whether that be making a school lunch, doing laundry, or helping with homework. When I was a child, I remember hearing for the first time that there are only two things certain in this world, death and taxes. I thought back then that those people clearly never knew Mom. It was wanting to be certain that Mom would always provide everything that was needed for her children. Mom's selfless acts for her children were endless. Even when Mom was sick and even when I told her not to worry about doing anything, Mom did everything anyways and always had everything prepared for the next day. This often meant that Mom would stay up until the wee hours of the night. Some nights when Mom would stay up late, I'd stay up late with her to help her do whatever she needed. During these times, Mom and I would watch Three's Company and I Love Lucy while talking about anything and everything about life. Mom was surprisingly opinionated during these late night conversations, where we would talk about anything from academics and sports to politics and religion. Although we could disagree on highly contested topics, one thing was certain. Mom would always treat me the same and would never judge me for thinking differently, even if it was on a topic where Mom held sincere convictions. Mom loved her children regardless of how they thought or what they did. And she would often say that a parent's love is only love, it's unconditional. I always wondered how in the world Mom could have had seven children. I received the answer to this question when Mom and Dad visited me in Tulsa, Oklahoma on my first Father's Day. I'll never forget when Mom held Bennett, my son, for the first time. Her eyes lit up like a firework finale on the 4th of July. Mom had a way of calming and burping a baby that parenting textbooks couldn't teach. As an amateur first-time dad, I needed all the help that I could get. I remember feeding my infant son a bottle and burping him afterwards, but he was still a little fussy. Mom asked, "Did you burp him?" I said, "Yeah, I got several burps up. I think I got all his gas." She said, "I think he still has some gases, so let me give it a try." Sure enough, she was right. Like a seasoned professional working her craft that she had mastered over the years of caring for seven children, she was able to get several more burps up after magically pressing and patting his back. Not long, too long after that, little Bennett fell asleep in her arms. I'll never forget the tips and tricks that Mom gave me for how to care for a newborn on that Father's Day. Mom was also as humble as she was selfless. Mom never boasted, no matter the praise or accolades given for doing outstanding work. After telling her that she was unbelievably skilled at calming a baby, she would respond with, quote, "Well, I just applied what I learned over the years for caring for 7 children. Her humble nature carried over into every area of her life. Mom was also an exceptional pianist. Like downplaying her child's caregiving prowess, she never bragged about her piano skills either. I love hearing Mom play the piano, whether that be Here Comes Santa Claus at the Christmas, or the Kirkham Family Christmas Party, or I Know That My Redeemer Lives at Church. Mom's piano renditions were truly a work of art that delighted her spectators' ears and warmed the hearts of all those in attendance. Often Mom would ask how she did or how it sounded after playing the piano, worrying that somehow she missed a minuscule note. I'd respond, "Mom, I say this objectively, you couldn't play a more exquisite rendition of the song you were playing. Even a professional performer would have to agree." But as usual, Mom's humble disposition would only gracefully accept the compliment by saying thank you. Faith and perseverance were two of Mom's other most notable characteristics. I never met a person that could persevere through obstacle after obstacle while staying so positive. Mom was diagnosed with one health ailment after another. Some of these ailments included a rare stage 4 cancer, a severe case of celiac disease, and a hip surgery that resulted in Mom having one leg more than 4 inches longer than the other leg. Theodore Roosevelt may have described Mom best when he said, quote, "Courage is not having the strength to go on, it is going on when you don't have the strength," end quote. Despite having this plethora of health ailments, Mom's positive and grateful spirit remained unbreakable as she continued to live the best life that she could under challenging circumstances. I have to tell Mom that I admired her positive attitude and unwavering gratitude for life. Mom frequently left me speechless and amazed because she rarely ever complained about her ailments. Instead of complaining, Mom would continuously say, quote, "I'm thankful for every breath, minute, hour, and day that the good Lord gives me," end quote. Mom could frequently be found singing church hymns like "Count Your Many Blessings, Name Them One by One," "Beauty Everywhere," and "Because I've Been Given Much." Mom taught me what it means to be truly grateful for what one has in life. Mom's faith and earnest belief that God would heal and comfort her enabled her to persevere and happily endure to the end. This faith also brought forth miracles and happy endings, as Mom always seemed to beat the medical odds given to her. I'll never forget when Dad informed my brother Jared and I of the grim news about Mom's stage 4 cancer diagnosis. Hearing that Mom only had months to live was agonizing and deeply troubling for a 13-year-old to process. But despite all odds, Mom lived more than 25 more years after that cancer diagnosis. Mom's stature may have been small, but she had an insurmountable will, courage, and determination to live, to be with her and her family. The one thing that saddened Mom the most about her health challenges was that she was not able to spend as much time with her children and grandchildren. Because of Mom's endless love, she always wanted her family to stay close to one another. And this meant that she wanted all of her 7 children to be close to home. Mom hated saying goodbye to her children, whether they moved away or left on a mission. In addition, Mom never liked to say goodbye on the phone either. If you had to put Mom on hold, you could be rest assured that she'd wait as long as it took until you came back on the phone. Because Mom hated goodbyes, I knew that informing Mom that I would be moving to Tulsa, Oklahoma to attend law school would be hard to hear. When I broke the news, she was a mixed bag of emotions. On the one hand, she was joyful and proud of me for obtaining a scholarship to fund law school. On the other hand, she was concerned because she worried that she wouldn't see me very often, if at all. I reassured her not to worry because I'd come home to visit, and moving away didn't mean forever. 5 months later, when I came home to visit for Christmas, I gave Mom a plaque that said, quote, "It's never goodbye, it's always see you later." Mom cried tears of joy when she opened that gift, as she knew that I'd be back again to see her. The days leading up to Mom's passing, I became fully aware of why Mom hated goodbyes. The circumstances had changed. And now I found myself grappling with the heart-wrenching reality of saying goodbye to Mom. Unlike when I moved away, this goodbye meant the agonizing truth that I could no longer see or hear her voice on the phone. And While I knew that her absence would become an unfillable void in my life, I did take some comfort in her passing because of three things. First, I remembered a quote from Helen Keller, a woman that Mom had admired, which once said, quote, "The best and most beautiful things in the world cannot be seen or even touched. They must be felt with the heart," end quote. While we may not be able to see or talk to Mom again, her memory and voice will always live on in the hearts and minds of those who knew her. Second, I take comfort in knowing that Mom is now completely unfeathered from all her health ailments, allowing her to now be free from any pain. And lastly, I take comfort in knowing that when Mom is not busy doing the Lord's work in heaven or enjoying a joyful stroll down memory lane with her past loved ones, she will be around to visit her family. As Mom now knows, it is truly never goodbye. It is always see you later. I say the same to Jesus Christ. Amen.
When I was a little girl, until I was 8 years old, I lived in a very humble four-room home in American Fork. In this home, there was a living room, there was a kitchen, a bathroom, and a bedroom. Jeanette and I shared a much smaller than twin-sized bed. She slept at one end and I slept at the other. Shalisa, baby then, slept in the crib, and Mom and Dad shared a very small double bed. There was no closets in this room, in this bedroom. Our clothes were kept in a makeshift closet. It was a cardboard box where a rod was strung through the top and Mom's and Dad's clothes hung. Our clothes were kept in the very bottom of this box, and I remember each morning my mom, with a smile on her face, would kneel down by this box and search through it until we found those exact clothes we wanted to wear. She took a lot of shuffling to make sure that we kept our perfect outfits. Money was tight then, but Mom wanted to make sure we had fun. With no washer and dryer at home, every 2 weeks, Mom and Dad would take all these clothes, except for the ones on our backs, to the laundromat. There was only enough money to do the wash, but not to dry. So all these clothes were brought back home, and this is where the fun began. The next step was to hang strings of rope through the house, and these clothes were hung on those ropes. And Jeanette and I played hide and seek. Mom made sure we had fun. This was a magical wonderland for two young kids. And these days, Dad would haul feed to dairy farms. Once a week, we'd all hop in this huge diesel truck. We'd stop at four different locations, in Ridgeville, Monroe, Junction, and Circleville. This adventure sometimes would take up to 8 hours round trip. This tour could have been very taxing, but Mom wanted to make sure we had fun. In this big diesel, Jeanette and I sat in a cab bed, and Mom showed us how to make a fort. She closed the curtains behind, and we were in this magical fort. She'd open those curtains, and we'd look out and survey our kingdom through those huge glass windows. Mom made us picnic lunches. We had chicken sandwiches, boiled eggs, and chocolate chip cookies. When this big truck stopped, and we'd all get out, and Jeanette and I would sit and look at all the big pigs and cows that were just huge. I remember loving our field trips and adventures. Mom loved to make birthday cakes. She made cakes, theme cakes, of teddy bears, Easter baskets, football, baseball and bats, a Barbie. And even when my sister Allie graduated from cosmetology school, she made a scissor and a comb. If you dreamed this kind of a cake, any cake, she'd make it. My favorite cake was when Mom made a carousel cake. This cake was equipped with colored straws and you had the cookies around, and on top was a cardboard, well, more of a paper top folded into a fan. I was so excited to light candles on this cake. And as soon as I helped do this, poof, it was a fire. And I will never forget. Big birthday parties continued through the years. We got bigger and better. We would have sleepover parties and rent VCR, at least three movies. We'd go to Blockbuster. We were so excited to watch these movies and stay awake all night. We ate red licorice, Doritos, and Starburst, our favorites. As we grew into adulthood, these cakes and birthday parties were replaced with birthday cards. Mom would spend hours writing heartfelt birthday cards to all of her children.
In these cards, Mom would bear her testimony of how much she loved Heavenly Father. These are a few phrases that she wrote to me. Colette, today is your beautiful day. The sun is shining, perfect temperature, birds singing. How special it is it's your birthday. I will never forget the joy and happiness that I felt when you were born. Your life is precious. It is truly a gift from God. How honored and blessed I am to be your mother. Always remember your Heavenly Father and Jesus Christ. They love you so much. They know you by name and have blessed you with so many blessings. Your talents and abilities are gifts from your Father in heaven. Always remember your blessings, that they are from the Lord, that He's blessed you. God created you in His image and sent you here to be successful and to have joy in your journey. He that honored God will honor. Power comes from within. Faith, staying close to the Lord, working with your heart and soul, with a sincere prayer in your heart and mind. Trusting in the Spirit to lead you along, the Savior will be by your side to accomplish anything you set your mind to. Colette, remember the Savior by your side that you can trust and will lead in your accomplishments that are even you think impossible. May the Lord continue to bless you. All my love, Mom. My mother wrote her mom birthday cards as well as Mother Day's cards. She wrote this to her mother in 2001. To a wonderful mother on Mother's Day, how special you are in my life. I am so thankful that you are my mother and Heavenly Father sent me to you. I'm so thankful for all that you have done for me, the great example that you are and all that you have taught me. Everything I am and will be, I owe to you. I am so thankful that you are with us in your later years and that you are doing so well. May the Lord continue to bless you with health and strength. I love you with all my love, Leona. Mom taught us through hard work how to work. Mom was singing primary song. Saturday is a special day, a day to get ready for Sunday. We cleaned and we cleaned, a 7-hour bathroom clean. All things inside the house must be cleaned. We had old metal spring beds. These beds built up dust. So we were instructed to take these beds out to the backyard, hook up the garden hose, and spray these beds down. Everything was washed. There was not a spot of dust to be found when we were finished. Mom taught us what it meant to have a garden. We planted it, we cared for it, used every last bit of it that it produced. We spent many summer, fall days, and nights picking beans, snipping beans, slicing beans, blanching beans, and putting beans into bags to freeze. If it could be frozen, we froze it. Mom had a motto: you use it up, you wear it out, you make it do, or you go without. I am very grateful that my mom taught me how to work and to work hard. I agree with Nephi when I said, I have been born of goodly parents. Both have strong and unwavering testimonies that I have put my feet on the covenant path. I am so grateful that I chose to be their daughter. M. Russell Ballard said, there is nothing more in this world as personal and as nurturing, as a life-changing, as an influence of a righteous mother. My mom was that righteous mother, righteous woman that influenced me and helped me into the person I am today. Mom has a quote on her wall that says, a mother holds her child's hand for just a short time, but holds to their heart forever. Mom, you will forever be in my heart. I am so grateful that I have the knowledge that families can be together forever. And I'm so grateful that I know that I will see you again. Say this in Jesus Christ. Amen.
I feel my Savior's love.
I think she was born that way. she came out having a testimony. The veil was thin with her to know that God was her father. And she made sure that all of us knew that. One of my fondest memories was going in the mountains. I remember as a little kid holding her hand. And we would walk down the gravel road and she'd sing this to me. In the leafy treetops, the birds sing good morning. They are first to see the sun. They must tell everyone. In the leafy treetops, the birds sing good morning. In my pretty garden, the flowers are nodding. They say, how do you do, they say. How are you today? In my pretty garden, the flowers are nodding. She loved the flowers. The last thing my mom said to me, I kneeled down next to her bed and she grabbed her hand and she touched my cheek and she said, Michael, never stop smiling. So, I'm going to try to tell you some things that made me smile. Mom taught me. When I was little, there was a time in my life when there was just me and my four sisters. We learned that Mom, Saturdays was a special day. And we would work together cleaning inside and out of the house. My sisters loved to play with dolls, dress up, and play house. But me, I wasn't having that. I was the only boy, and I liked to swing a bat, throw a ball. I like to play outside. I like to play downstairs in the unfinished basement and hang out with Dad. And sometimes when I was little, cleaning got overwhelming and I would go on adventures. This one particular Saturday, after many hours of cleaning, Mom couldn't find me. She looked all around. Once she realized that Michael was gone, she would search the house top to bottom. Then she got David involved, my dad, and he searched. And then all my sisters, they searched. They called neighbors. They called, I'm pretty sure my dad called the highway patrolman and asked that they would keep an eye out for me. There was an orchard behind our house that had an irrigation ditch, and one of the biggest fears, my mom. My mom had that I would run out there and I would get swept away in the irrigation ditch. And after it seems like forever looking for me, they couldn't find me. They thought that's what happened. Everyone was on the lookout for me. Mom searched the house 3-4 times, top to bottom. Nothing. She told me that she found a quiet place in the house after she'd done all that she could do, and she prayed. And she asked her Heavenly Father to help her find her son. And the answer came clear, go downstairs. And she thought, I've been down there 3-4 times. But Mom always followed the promptings. She went downstairs, and there I was, in my red coat, laying on a red cooler, in the prenatal position, fast asleep. She must have walked by me 3-4 times, but I was just fast asleep. I tucked my legs in the coat with my hood on, and she couldn't find me. I remember waking up at a young boy's age, my mom hugging me and telling me that she loved me. And she was so grateful that I was okay. She brought me upstairs and told everyone that she found Michael. And they were so excited to see me and hug me. And who knew how much attention you'd get for just taking a nap. My mom was one of a kind. She would take us,
She'd take us to school on days that were bad, snowy weather. On those other days, I'd walk or ride my bike, but when it came to the snowy days, Mom got to take us. And Mom, she loved to drive her 82 Buick. This car was brown, longer than a trailer, and we nicknamed it the tuna boat. It was that big. And she was so small that she could barely see above the dash as she drove. And Mom, she was always doing things, so she was late, always late. And I remember saying, Mom, we gotta go to school, we're gonna be late. She said, I think we can make it. Get in the car. I'd get in the car, I would grab the dash, white knuckle, and I would pray that we'd get there safe. She would throw in gear, spin the tires, get out of the driveway, and then she'd throw in gear, spin the tires, and go downhill. There was a hill not too far from our house that she'd come flying off the hill because she didn't want to be late for school, and she couldn't stop at the bottom, and she slid right through the intersection. Not once, not twice, multiple times. That's why I was holding on for dear life. Many a days did we find the tuna boat stuck in a snowbank. But don't worry, we got out the same way we got in. Throw in gear, spin the tires, throw in gear, spin the tires. We got out. She would take us to school, and we got there on time. Most of the time. My mom didn't like the name tuna boat too much, but we used to call it also the BMW. She liked that name better because that meant the big Mormon wagon, and that all the family would get in to the BMW. So she thought that was okay. So at school, one day, my sister Colette, she decided on her walk home, it wasn't a bad day, it was a good day, so she didn't have to get taken to school, that there was a cat that came up and befriended her. Colette thought it would be unhumane if she didn't take this cat home. And so she stuffed it in her backpack, took it home. This cat got out, Mom looked at it, and I don't think we had any pets before that. And so Mom was like, I don't know about this cat, but Colette, she put the charm on, and you could see how much the cat meant to Colette. So Mom decided to take the cat in. Now, interesting things about cats is you don't choose cats for pets, they choose you. They can go, they come and go when they want to, so you can tell a good owner because they choose you. This cat was named Blackie, and this was the mother of all cats in our house. Pretty soon, Blackie got pregnant, had babies. Those babies had babies. Pretty soon, they multiply and replenish the earth in our backyard. We had cats everywhere. At one point, my friends called it the cat house. There were so many cats there. One time, I remember my friend Brock drove out of the driveway and ran over one of those mother cats. And that wasn't something that happened quite often. There's not many cats. So it got ran over, but that was one of the mother cats. And she just got done having a litter of six kittens. And they were in the window well right by our porch. And they'd hear them cry, and their mom was gone. So what did Mom do? Mom took those cats in, and with the help of Stephen, gave them the neonatal care that it took to raise them and to bring them back to life. She took syringes and eye drops full of warm milk to
feed them for weeks and weeks. She would wash them. And she would call these things. And she's that person. She just nourished everything she touched. She took care of those cats. Now, Mom didn't always like the cats. There's times that the cats, she wasn't having it either. Like when they run in the house and try to scratch the furniture with their claws, there was this one time that one of the cats ran in and we were trying to get it out, and it ran up the drapes in the kitchen, just up the drapes. Mom grabbed the broom and took the biggest swing at it that I've ever seen. I think I know where I get my baseball swing from. There was also a time where, after we retired the tuna boat, we traded it in. We got a real nice Chevy Astroman minivan. And that's what she drove around after that. Well, we got home from the grocery store and taking the groceries into the house, one of the cats decided to come in the minivan. And the door was shut and it couldn't get out. The next morning, Mom comes to drive, and there's the cat on the dash looking at her. Now, if you can imagine, when we open the door and let the cat out, that tomcat had sprayed everywhere. You think trying to get smoke out of the poultry is hard? Trying to get the smell of a tomcat after it's marked its territory. From that day on, Mom drove the tomcat. Mom kind of took on characteristics from the cats, meaning I think she had 9 lives. There were things that happened to her that should have ended her life, but it didn't. Just like cats, I believe Mom had 9 lives. One of the times was when I was on my mission, she wrote me this letter. And out of the blue, she tells me the story of when she got hit by lightning. How many people do you know got hit by lightning? But she tells a story that she was talking on the phone, doing dishes, and the phone was hooked to the wall, and all of a sudden this loud noise, she remembers, and then all of a sudden she was thrown across the kitchen and underneath the kitchen table about 10 feet away. She had no idea what happened. She was a little dazed and confused, and Stephen comes home, finds her white as a ghost. Steve didn't know what to do either, so he went outside to play with the cats, obviously, so he went outside. The tree next to the house was hit by lightning. All the bark was gone. It was white. It looked like the tree of life, where the bark was all over the lawn, steaming. The tree was hit by lightning, and the lightning went through the house, the foam cord, through the wires, and shocked Mom as she was doing the dishes. Mom definitely lived through some crazy things. Another thing that really was really crazy was when, after I got home from a mission, Mom got diagnosed with cancer. In 1998, in September, the doctor told our family that she was diagnosed with stage 4 cancer. She had 2 to 4 months to live. Mom wasn't happy any of that. Mom was a woman of faith. She asked for a blessing. And in that blessing, she was told that she'd live, that she would see her kids grow up, and that she'd see her grandkids. 25 years later, Mom did see that. You know, it's not the dog in the fight but the fight and dog that matters the most. Mom is a fighter. She knew when it was her time to go, and 25 years ago, it wasn't. Mom taught me to always have a good attitude, even when it was hard, and even when life dealt you a hand that wasn't fair. She always taught you, me and her children, to look on the bright side. I remember Mom teaching me, whether I think I can do it or I think I can't, I was right. Life's 90% what happens to you. Mom taught me that attitude was 10% what happens to you in life and 90% how you feel about it. She was always someone I looked up to. She was 5 foot nothing for a long time, and even though she was so small, I always looked up to her. In closing out, I want to read this poem. I've been in this hole for a very long time, in the dark and the damp and the cold and the slime. The shaft was above me, I could see it quite clear, but there's no way I could ever reach it from here. Nor could I remember the world way up there, so I was lost, all my hope, and gave into despair. I knew nothing but darkness, the floor and the walls. Then off in the distance, I heard someone call. Get up, get ready. There's nothing matter. Take rocks, old sticks, and build up a fine ladder. This had never occurred to me, had never crossed my mind. But I started to stack all the stones I could find. When I ran out of stones, the old sticks were my goal. For one way or another, I would get out of this hole. So I soon had a ladder that was sturdy and tall, and I thought, I'll soon leave this place once and for all. I climbed up my ladder. It was no easy chore, for lifting those boulders, my shoulders were sore. I climbed up the ladder, but soon had to stop. For my ladder stopped short, some 10 feet from the top. I climbed down my ladder and started to cry. I've done all I could do. I gave it my best try. And in spite of my work, in this hole I must die. And all I could do was sit and think why. Was my ladder too short or my hole way too deep? Then, from way upon high, came a voice, do not weep. And then faith, hope, and love entered my chest, as the voice said to me that I have done my best. He said, you've worked very hard, and your labor's been rough. But the ladder you built is at last tall enough. Do not despair. You have reason to hope. Just climb up your ladder and I'll throw down my rope. I climbed up the ladder, then climbed up the cord. When I got to the top, there stood the Lord. I couldn't be happier, my struggles were done. I blinked at the brightness that came from the sun. I fell to the ground, his feet did I kiss. I cried, "What can I do to repay you for this?" Then he looked all about him. There were holes in the ground. They had people inside and were seen all around. There were thousands of holes that were damp, dark, and deep. The Lord turned to me and said, "Feed my sheep." Then he went on his way to help other lost souls. And I got right to work, calling down to the holes, "Get up, get ready. There is nothing a matter. Take rocks, old sticks, and build up a fine ladder." Yet now was my turn to spread the good word, the most glorious message that man has ever heard. There is one who's willing to save one and all, and we've got to be ready when he gives the call. He'll pull us all out of the holes that we're in and save our souls from death and from sin. So do not lose faith. There's reason to hope. Just build up your ladder and he'll throw down his rope. In life, it's not if, but when we find ourselves in one of those holes that we need help to get out of. And I'm grateful for the Savior that is always there for us to help us when we need his help, when we've done all that we can do. He makes a difference. Mom believed that. I believe Mom had his image on her countenance. She loved the Lord, and so do I. And I say that in the name of Jesus Christ, amen.
Regard me on thee, Lord. Thank you, Brother Rich. That song was a love song, to be honest. Touring, it is the cry of every human heart. Divine Redeemer. Thank you to Sister Jepson for your rendition of those primary melodies. They were beautiful. And to you, Sister Summers, for accompanying those numbers. And thanks to Sister Gilmore and Sister Herbst for their participation as well. And thanks to the Bishopric and the Elders Quorum and Henry Society in the preparation for this funeral. And thanks for you for coming, all of your friends, relatives, extended family, work associates. We appreciate it. I'm grateful for our family, for our sons and our daughters. They spent a lot of time these last few months with tender care given to their mother. It was just inspiring to watch them work together and take care of their mothers with such tender care. And I'm grateful also for their spouses. Without the spouses, I don't think they could have done what they did. So thank you for what you've done. If I left anybody out, I apologize, but just thanks so much. Those of you who have observed Leona know very well that I so much worried about myself. I have become a better person as I have loved to live with her. We have been complimentary beyond anything I could have imagined. Rather than dividing us, our differences bound us together. She is a virtuous woman and a righteous mother. You will quickly see that purity and goodness in her comments. I thank her for the woman she is, for the lessons she has taught me, and for the love we share. Leona's passing has been by far the most difficult, life-changing event that has ever happened to me. Gratefully, our children and I have a glorious assurance that we have not lost her. But reality remains that we can't call her on the phone, we can't see her in person, and we can't tease her about her quirks. Death is a gateway along the path of eternal progress. Though hard for those of us left behind, we know the resurrection is certain, and eternal life lies ahead. Death is both a necessity and a blessing. God's gate plan, great plan of happiness, requires each of us pass through that gateway. Leona's righteous spirit is now born again in the paradise of God. She continues on her path to eternal life. How grateful I am today to know where my precious Leona is, and that we will be together again with her family for all eternity. Our sweet memories have played across my mind with the home movie marathon. Hilarious moments, experiences, both sweet and somber. Times she defended me when I didn't deserve it. And even her reprimands have all come back to me in waves, along with the reality that when Leona stepped across the veil, that one person who had believed in me since the day we were married is no longer here. I thank her for one unselfish act after another that she had done for us. She never saw herself as anything but the most ordinary woman. But there was nothing ordinary about her goodness, her love, and devotion to her family. Leona always saw the beauty and good in everyday life, even though faced with many health challenges and the cruelty that life presented. She never not once complained or ever expressed self-pity. Leona turned to the love of life. She knew to cherish every day as a blessing from God, and lived it as well as she was able, striving to reach her loftiest potential. Leona was passionate about the beauty everywhere of the mountains. She was overwhelmed by the unspoiled beauty, pristine quiet, and peace she experienced. She felt a connection inside of her by being on the tops of the mountains. She loved the scenery and smells of the Mantine Sound, the sweet fragrance of the wildflowers, the refreshing aroma of a pine after rain, the wintergreen scent of willows along the spring banks, and the musky sweet of the autumn leaves. She especially enjoyed riding in her side-by-side for miles and miles on forest byways and trails with her family. And in regards to our sweetheart tree, we never imagined that a simple expression of love by carving our names on an aspen tree would become a tradition so meaningful and important to our family, for which we are so grateful. In a marvelous way, it defines the character of our family legacy. She is a peacemaker by providing comfort to others, healing sadness and bringing joy. She lived a life of consequences, and yet still impacted many in times of need. There's no way to include all the sentiments others gave her, from her kind thank you cards, phone calls, and visits. She had a lot to give, gave it, and asked for nothing in return. Leona is the daughter of every parent's dream. She is a perfect sister, a trusted friend. She carried the crown of Miss Lehigh in dignity to the end of her reign, and passed it to another having served with honor. Cheerful in all weathers, never shirked a task, splendid behavior. She had a special way of making everyone feel valued, loved, and heard. When asked, "How are you doing?" she would proudly say, "I'm working on it." Supportive and caring wife. Coming home from work, seeing her standing at the door with a sparkle in her eyes and a smile on her face was a perfect ending to a difficult day's work. Has unlimited capacity of love. She is an example of the kind of love that the Apostle Paul in his epistle to the Corinthians called charity. She suffers long. She is kind, humble, and unselfish. She envieth not, is not puffed up. She rejoices in truth, bears all things, and endures all things. Devoted wife, loving mother, grandmother, and great-grandmother. She is a woman of fearless faith. Small in stature, mighty in spirit. Cherished Relief Society sister. Faithful member of the church with an unmovable testimony of the restoration and her Savior Jesus Christ. Leona has a kindness about her that permeates the corners of everyone's heart. Favorite flower, rose, red or yellow. Favorite season, autumn. She penned thank you notes, birthday cards, appreciation letters, which came from her heart, dictated by the Spirit. There were no coincidences. She referred to them only as miracles in life. She leaves behind the legacy of love, hope, kindness, and compassion that will be treasured by those who are fortunate enough to cross her path. Leona is a member of a large population of invisible people who really never get attention or noticed. just for being who they are, for what they contribute to others. She is the most innocent and pure sense of love for others. It's always been about others, not about herself. As her health declined, she was asked to prepare a weekly scripture for the recent society. Now, we may think that is a pretty neat calling, go to anyone in the standard work and just pluck out a scripture and come and do it. But not Leona. She never shared the task. She was committed to fulfill her calling. She would study the lesson with its accompanying scriptures, then she would go to her knees in prayer. Seek guidance to know the perfect scripture that would totally define the lesson and always, always found it. Leona wanted so much to work in the temple, but was unable because of her health. She found another way, however, to be involved by finding a sacred connection. That is submitting names to the temple. I would watch her. Prepare a list of names who she felt needed help, and then humbly pray for every name. She would then go over those names, and as the Spirit directed her, she would make a check by only the name as prompted that would be entered onto the prayer rolls to be placed on the altars of the temple. She learned and followed the admonition of the Holy Spirit. Trust in the Lord with all thine heart, and lean not into thine own understanding. In all thy ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct thy paths. I was at least allowed to tack along at every stop she made. I don't know if a person could do so much for so little. She was everything a companion could be in this world, and I thank God we'll have each other in the next life. Her faith was kindled and rooted in the goodness of Jesus Christ, refined and tempered in the furnace of life's afflictions. She prayed all the time about everything. She was as loyal to her covenants and her Heavenly Father as any woman could possibly be. It is impossible to think about Leona without thinking about her love for the Lord. To our children, know that the combination of mom's faith and love allowed you to glimpse the Savior's love. Perhaps the most painful part of losing mom this week is realizing that the one person on this earth who loved them first and loved them longest and loved them the most is gone. But she has left them with a greater gift, the knowledge that there is one in heaven who loves him even more. During some quiet time in the hospital, I asked her what date was the most important in her life. Is it your birthday, our children's birthday, or could possibly be a death date? She paused momentarily, looked into my eyes, and said April 14th, 1967. That's the day we were sealed in the Salt Lake Temple as eternal companions for all eternity. She knows the significance of saving ordinances and the importance of covenants she made that day in the temple. As I look upon her casket surrounded by these beautiful flowers, I can truly say there lies an honest woman, an elect lady, a woman of great worth. I don't know of any other woman who would endure every species of fatigue and illness from month to month and year to year with unflinching courage, zeal, and patience, which she has ever done. She knew that if she were faithful, all her losses, hurt, and suffering would be made up. It's not what we achieve in life, it's what we overcome that defines us. She is a lamp at my feet and light to my path. I love her dearly, and I am honored to be her husband. What will I miss about Leona? Everything. What is her plea to all of us? Love one another. She was born into this world with the knowledge of the Heavenly Father, Jesus Christ, in the Restoration. She taught of it, she testified of it, she knew it to be true, and cannot deny it. We have come to Earth for two reasons, to receive a body and to be tested. We have been given two things. We have been given time, and we've been given choice to choose what we will do for the time allotted to us. We can seek base desires. We can search the world over for untold riches and treasures. We can pursue fame and glory. Leona chose to be in the service of the Savior Jesus Christ. Her favorite scripture. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven. Truly we have seen your light shine brightly, and our good works glorify your Father in heaven. As we travel through our long journey on earth, of life and death, let it be life eternal, that we may live the way God lives. I so testify the name of our Savior, my Redeemer, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Charity suffereth long and is kind. Charity envieth not. Charity wanteth not itself, is not puffed up, doth not behave itself unseemly, seeketh not her own, is not easily provoked, thinketh no evil, rejoiceth not in iniquity, but rejoiceth in the truth, beareth all things, believeth all things, hopeth all things, endureth all things. Leona had charity. And although she was ill in the later years, and many of us didn't get to know her as much as we would have liked, her kind acts will live in the hearts of many. I never had a conversation with her that wasn't positive and uplifting. If we want to remember the life of Leona Earle, try to have charity as she did. May the Lord bless each of us as we try to become like Leona, and thus becoming like our Savior as we have charity is my prayer for each of us in the holy name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Brothers and sisters, we will now sing our closing hymn, I Need Thee Every Hour, hymn number 86, after which our benediction will be offered by Jared Burr, son-in-law. After our closing prayer, we invite those of you who are pallbearers to follow the casket along with the family out to the north doors to my right. And then we will proceed to the Lehigh Cemetery for the dedication grave, which will be offered by Michael D. Gray, Leonis.
We ask thee, Father, that
we can each be better people. That we can learn from those things that Leona taught us. That we can be happier people, more loving people. Help us to reach out to those that, as she would have, to make somebody's day better. We ask a blessing upon each of the family members, that they can feel the love and remember those wonderful memories from Leona. We give thee thanks for the gospel in our lives, for the plan of salvation. For we know that this is part of the cycle of life. We know that we will see her again. These things we pray for, and give thanks for. Do so in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.